We're glad we could come worship with you. I live in Bonanza. I work at a child treatment center for delinquent youth called Klamath County Youth Ranch. We work with delinquent teenage boys who are drug offenders, committed law violations, who are ward of the court, and their lives are totally messed up. And that's what the Lord called me to do right now.
My name is John. Mark over there too. Jon Speyer. Will is my brother-in-law, which means we married sisters.
And he had boys too.
Because I only have two. We still have one more chance.
One more?
My oldest son, Ryan, is just over two. We're heading on three. And my youngest son is 2 months old. The sisters decided they have their kids at the same time. I don't know what we have to do with it. His name is Brandon. I'm from the same place that Will's from. Before that, I was from Watsonville, Santa Cruz area down in California. My dad teaches at Monterey Bay Academy, Bible teacher. I'm a PTA. And love every minute of it. My wife, Kinsey, is in the back trying to hold me. And I'm the teacher at the treatment center. Will's the guy that beats up on them when they get out of camp. He's the kind of guy that tries to teach them. And that's how.
And my name is Ed Whitlock, and as you can see, I'm playing this horse thing over here for this family. I'm from Klamath. We're all from the Klamath area. I'm from Klamath Falls, being a teen. And I teach music down there with this county school, and right now I got my head above water, so it's just fine. And that's about.
You got a wife?
Oh, that's right. Yeah, but they're not here. I tried to talk them into coming up here, but they have other plans. So. But, you know, I have felt very, I want to say one thing about this church. I've never been to this church before. You took our pastor away from us about a year ago. But I want to tell you that the Irwins did ride by me a couple years ago. They let me stay in their home for a couple of weeks when they were, when I looked for work up down Klamath. I really have a lot of respect and love towards that family, and I'm sure you do too. Also, I would like to say that this family here of Evans, as they do feel, this church, very welcome. Thank you.
I guess it's my turn. My name is Mark Trethewey. I'm also from Klamath Falls. I'm a student at Oregon Institute of Technology. I'm studying engineering. And my wife is right back there waiting. She's holding a little baby. I told a little kid, last time we were here, Will and John and my wife, all three of us, had pregnant wives. We all have babies now.
That's good, Mark.
She's a little girl.
She got a girl.
She's our first child, and we're really happy to be here.
My name is Beth Price. I'm a medical assistant from Klamath Falls. This is my husband sitting on the front row. There's a fan there and he's going to kill me.
He's the only grandpa out of him in the room.
I'm dead.
They don't have the kids, but we're putting the pressure on, let me tell you.
They told me not to get long-winded, and I'm going to try here. No, I'm not. The story in the Bible I was reading this morning again is in 2 Samuel, and it's the story of a man I'm sure you're well aware of. It's Absalom. If you remember the story, it starts with his brother, Amnon, doing a rather despicable thing to his stepsister Tamar. Of course, it ends up actually killing Amnon and then having to flee for his life. He's as good as a dead man. He deserves to die. But he flees, and he's gone for a few years. Of course, David's heart is gone out to his son, and there's this conflict, and that's the primary thing that I want you to catch in your mind. The conflict is, here David is, a father who loves extremely, loves his son, loves this gorgeous, beautiful man. That's what the Bible says. He's a beautiful man. Not too many beautiful men in the world, he's beautiful for ladies, but he's a beautiful man with long hair. At the same time, he's a king. and team is a full justice where we have anarchy. Well, Joab does his little trick, and the woman of Tekoa comes and talks to David. And David misconstrues the words and calls his son Absalom back. Totally forgiven. Of course, everyone in the kingdom is taking notes. Well, as you read the story, Absalom takes and he burns the field of Joab, and Joab was the one responsible for bringing it back. And then, besides taking Joab and kicking him in the face, he does the same thing with his father. He wins the hearts of all of Israel away from his father to himself, and drives his father out. And when you catch the story a few chapters later, you have Absalom fighting with David in the forest of Ephraim. And there, even though David had told Joab and his men not to kill Absalom, they end up catching Absalom in a tree, hung by his hair, and they cast three darts through his heart. Now, I've heard that story told that Absalom is the bad boy. Now, don't be like Absalom. But that's not what I think the story is telling me. I think you and I are Absalom. Because God confronted the same problem, apparently so, in that he had to be a king who would uphold his law, had to have a standard of righteousness, required perfection. At the same time, he's a father who loves his subject. What did we do? We stole his kingdom. We stole his kingdom. The story changes everything. You notice in the last part of the story, after Absalom is dead, David says, Absalom, Absalom, oh my son Absalom, would that you had died in your place, my son Absalom. God died in our place. He did what David couldn't do. It's not something that we have to arrive at. Absalom was a beautiful man, by all appearances, perfection. With no spot or blemish, the Bible says. But inwardly, his heart was corrupt. And that's you and I. We perform well in church. We wear the right clothes, we say the right things, we study ourselves for lesson week, vegetarian, the whole trip. You know everything. You know it all. You've heard it all. You've done it all. You've seen it all. But we're just like Absalom. We have a heart. And every day of our lives, that heart must be subjected to Jesus Christ. For if it is not, we end up doing the same thing Absalom did, hating for ourselves. Christ died on the cross. Do two things. To show us that we are Absalom. And to show us that he loves us. Justice. Mercy. All rolled up in Jesus Christ. Absalom, Absalom. Would that I die for you. Thank you.
How would you like to become a doormat? How would you like to become a doormat? You know what that means? Something that lays in front of the door so when the kids come in, the mother can scream and say, "Have your feet before they come around." The salesman will always come there and they'll have one foot on the doormat and the other foot ready to get inside the door. That the dogs always sleep on, that we used to hide our keys under, that we lost them. The doormat is what the world and people are supposed to wipe their feet on. Jesus Christ came down and became a doormat. Didn't he? And the world wiped their feet on him. And he said, because of that, you've been redeemed. You know what makes me stay a Christian? Not my ability to be strong and to be good and to hang in there. It's his ability. It's not how bad I am, it's how good he is. Because salvation is so easy because it costs God so much. And the only reason why I stay in there is because he promised that he would, and he never left us. When I think about that, when I'm feeling good, I can kind of shine it on and it doesn't penetrate. But boy, when I need him, whenever you need somebody, you're glad that they're there, and you're glad that they kept their promise. And that's why I keep coming back, because I'm the one who's always leaving. Look at my life. I see a whole lot of changing, a whole lot of rearranging I must do before I get to heaven, before I am allowed to wear my crown. Look at the I'm too busy trying to be the kind.
I just like to read a passage of scripture where it came. Start with verse 34, it says, "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you and for the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me.' Then the righteous will answer you, saying, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, and thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you as a stranger and invite you in, and naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you?' And the king will answer and say to them, 'Truly I say to you, even if you've done the least of these, my brethren, you've done no good.'"
Always hear a priest about it. About the prodigal.
you ever really sat down and thought about that whole story? I mean, we hear it preached about, read it, talk about it, and we even make jokes about it. There's really three prodigals in that story. There's a son who runs away, does his thing, and is probably the next to the most honest in the group. Of course, the father is the one who never in love, who's given his Visa card, his American Express letter, who's given to all of his son, and loves him to the guttermost, and is out there meeting him before he gets home. There's another prodigal I think speaks most to us. And I think the main reason Christ told the story was the son who stayed home. The son who deserved something. Do you really deserve anything? Yeah. Yeah. And the son, after staying home all those years, gets upset when his brother comes home. It's kind of like the story in Matthew. There's one group of people that do all these things, and Lord, here we are, we're ready to go ribbon. Yeah, we're ready. And Lord said, I don't know you. And the other group, when did we do that? What are you talking about? Well, this other son is the wrong group. And what does the father say to him, even to him? All that I have is yours. Why do you call it? What's going to happen to somebody who maybe you live next door to, who's been the prodigal all their life? Say on the last day, whenever that last day is, gives their life to the Lord. So, you know, I went to church, I was the head elder, I was the personal ministry director, and I was almost perfect on my Sabbath school. What gets us into heaven? Nothing that we do, have done, or will be. What he's done. What he's already done. It's history. All that I have is yours. Even sitting here in church, in the bodies, Charles Spurgeon said it best. Church. Hospital for sinners, not a showcase for saints. Do you know that you're part of one? All that I have is yours.
Casino.
It really wasn't really at all. I saw something for the first time being here. You want to guess who that is, Mike? Here I am, just a question man, the reason I'm lying. I saw Mount Hood for the first time. I have seen pictures of it, and I've been up here times, and it's always cloudy or it's raining. And I have never been up here on a day like today. Is this standard? Hey, someone said amen. I think the real estate if you like to buy it. Beautiful up here, it really is. Somebody said, you know, the gentleman who shook his head, you know, he's declining in hair on his head. Now, I don't want to point that out to him. But the reason people, all the people can say, the reason why I'm bald, God likes me the best because I save him a lot of county. This down here, this Sandy River Gorge, that's beautiful. Is that on postcards or something? That is gorgeous. We went around the edge today and had to stop and ooh and ah. And you got to stop because if you don't, you're in someone else's lane, things like that. Jon and I mentioned that we work with teenagers who are really have shattered lives. What that means is, they're 16 and they're 17 years old and they're stepping into adulthood with innumerable problems and habits and deficiencies, which ultimately means they become total failures and they become supported by society and they're what we call them troublemakers and they go on living in the penitentiary. And so our efforts with them right now is to take them at a crossroads, to take them in a different direction. We have to prevent the inevitable from happening. But then when you look at their lives and you say, let's try to wrap this person together here in about 6 to 10 months, kind of reforming, reshaping, getting new attitudes, new perceptions, new goals, new identities, new feelings, new enthusiasm, and undo 16 years of neglect and abuse. It's a magic trick to do it. And it doesn't come easy. It doesn't come without the grace of God. These kids are the, you hear it on the TV, you hear it on the radio, child abuse here, neglect here. These are the kids who somehow made it through and became 16. And what do you think they're like now? Well, if they straighten up, you obey their rules, you know, don't be smart to your teacher, don't rip off the cars, leave the drugs alone, don't be living a sensual, promiscuous life, what's the matter with you? These are the kids who happen to grow up from all the abuse, from all the neglect, from the lack of care, and pain of love. And they cut the crack. Because they don't want to get hurt anymore. And it means to, in order to heal, they have to open up. And opening up means a chance of getting hurt again. Would you? It's a big risk. The risk is too great. But it works. Because there's a God in heaven, not because we're swift counselors. And we say all the right things because the books can be written and burned. But when the life changes, when he has no cause to change, that's a miracle. We are going to sing a song to you that will probably make you cry. But that's good. Because it means you have feelings. And we're living in a world that denies feelings. We drink it, and we smoke it, and we entertain it away because we don't want to feel. We don't want to feel bad. We always want to feel good. We don't really want to feel. It's the children who always feel. And the reason why this song will probably make some of you cry is because it's a song about the innocent. And the children are always innocent. It doesn't matter how you stack it. There's no war justifiable. There's no cause great enough. There's no principle or anything great enough to hurt the children. It really isn't. About 3 years ago, a little child came to the attention of my wife and I, a little girl, 3 years old, abused excessively physically. And she played with my son, and I just watched the difference, and I could see the fear in her eyes. And I said, there's a mother that's allowing this and doing this. And we wrote this song. And I hope I don't cry when I'm singing it, because I do sometimes. But it's a powerful song because it talks about the children that are suffering. And God never meant it to be that way. He really didn't.
Thank you. You don't know how, because it means you got to feel. You got to do something inside.
You might be clumsy, and you might be awkward, and people might misinterpret it, so you don't. No one gets healed, and you go by week after week. I was in a church in California, and they did a little healing exercise, and I wanted to bring it here and have you do it. You know what it means? It means turning around and standing up to somebody and taking their hand and telling them you love them. Will you do that? Can you touch somebody and say you love them? Can you go to somebody right now and say, I'm sorry because I need your forgiveness. I've been talking about you. It's hard. Oh boy, it's really hard. Would you turn to somebody and tell them you love them? Would you take their hand? Would you try it? Bow your head and have a prayer with them. Just say, I'm glad you're here. It's time to heal. It really is. We can hide behind our mask forever, and all we do is hurt. If anybody should know how to love, it's Christians. Because we have the perfect example. Now John is going to sing a song. I'm going to cry. I want to lift your heart and your eyes to where heaven and earth collided. And the pain was on the heart of God. Calvary, I want you to behold the pain.
They live.
think in your mind the worst man or the worst woman that you know, that you can think of, that has hurt you so many times, that has talked behind your back, or that has done unmentionable things to you. The worst one that you know, a human being that you know. See him? Now say, that man and that woman, perfect in Christ Jesus. If you can't say that, you haven't got the very beginning of Christian thinking, because that's the bedrock right there. You can't love your love. You can't say you gotta love more. You gotta understand that the redemption of the world has been won. I came to do the work which thou gavest me to do. What was finished? The redemption of the world. And every one of us, we can. There's no excuse for it. There's no excuse. If we claim to be the sons and daughters of Jesus Christ, it's time we start acting like it. We have it all. And it's just a matter of overcoming that pride by saying that man and that woman, they're perfect in Christ Jesus. It's all been won. That's the Christian litmus test. If you got a problem, then think of that person. If you're washing the dishes and you're thinking, oh, I know what I should have said to her. Why, I should have said that, I should have said, and you cut them up and you kill them. Or you're out on the lawn, you're thinking about what person did, and you hit him a million times over, you say all the words you should have said, you're just tearing up the lawn, doing it all right now. Just say, that's perfect, that man or that woman, perfect in Christ Jesus, and your heart begins to change, because that's the beginning of Christian thinking. What does Christ want from us? Kiss you.
Motivation for doing is to get something.
give us eternal life. Does that sound blasphemous? The assurance, I write these things to you that you might know that you have eternal life. Beyond a shadow of a doubt. How you feel sometimes? Like a roller coaster. Up and down, all around. That's not how I feel about Christ. I feel about me. And my will to say, our motivation, if we are to know that we have it, and that we are at the right hand of God right now, in Jesus Christ. Sit down and read Ephesians and count the ends. In Christ Jesus. We have this in Christ. In Christ. In Christ. We have all of heaven in Christ. We have the Holy Spirit in Christ. We have all those things. And God gives us both hands. He gives us the right to heaven and gives us the power to live every day of our lives. And what He became, we can only approximate. But He became poured out of me. Working for us.